Welcome everyone to another Bowls Victoria training video or webinar. It's been a while since our last training webinar, so it's great to be back and great to be in front of our members and looking forward to the new season. As you all know, tonight's session is about conditions of play. So for those people who I haven't met before, my name is Matt Ottobre. I'm the Education and Training Manager at Bowls Victoria. Joining me tonight, co-hosting tonight's session, is Jimmy Whitehead, Events and Competitions Manager. And our two experts, tonight's session would not go ahead without these two people. And we thank them because they've been in meetings all day today. Our experts, John Roberts and Bob Carlson, they're the co-chairs of Officiating and Laws Committee. If this is your first time jumping on an education webinar, they're quite different to the Zoom meetings that we're all used to. So you can only see the presenters' videos. You can't see each other, unfortunately. It's a little bit like the cinema. There is a Q&A button down the bottom though. So at any time tonight, if you would like to throw some questions in there, Jimmy will be looking after those. And we've got a section in tonight's session where we'll unpack some of those questions. Tonight is getting recorded, so just be aware of that. And we'll send that recording out to our 10 a.m. session, which unfortunately got cancelled, and we can put this up onto our website for all our members to see. The agenda for tonight, a little bit shorter than last year's one. We're going to start by looking at the difference between umpires, side managers, and the controlling body, and why they can't be the same person. We've had a few changes, not a lot, to the conditions of play. So we'll have a look at those changes, important changes that all our clubs need to know. Then we'll spend quite a bit of our time going through some of the commonly misunderstood conditions. And I know from last year's session, I was a lot clearer on what to do with wet weather. So we'll have a look at those. Jimmy will be manning the questions. So we'll get Jimmy on and have a look at some of those questions that our members have got. And then we'll just finish with looking at how you can get some support from Bowls Victoria. All right, we'll get started. We'll bring our experts on. So if I can get John and Bob to turn their videos on and mics.
Just
You've got me cut out, Matt.
No, I'm getting your video right on now for you. There you are, Bob.
Okay.
And we're just waiting for John to turn his video on.
One second. Just hang on 1 second.
No, you're right, John. While we get John to get his video on, Bob, do you want to start with the difference between umpire, side manager, and controlling body?
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, John, there you are.
Bob, you can start with the umpire and the side manager, and I'll do the controlling body.
Yeah, okay. It is recommended that they not be one and the same person, the side manager and the umpire. And the reason for that being that if the side managers are unable to reach agreement, they need to defer the decision to the umpire to make that decision. And it's unreasonable to have a person act as a side manager and then change their hat and become the umpire when side managers can't agree. Naturally, they'd come up with the decision that they wanted when they first addressed the question as a side manager. So, in some smaller clubs in particular, it'll be difficult to separate the roles, but ideally the side manager and the umpire should not be one in the same person.
Yep. So, the last couple of seasons, Bowls Victoria have asked that each club where they're playing pennant creates a person who is the actual controlling body. The laws of the sport quite clearly say, hierarchically, that in the end, the club where the game is being played is the controlling body. So it's on a rare occasion that the umpire would need to speak to the controlling body. And that could be things like weather, eligibility for substitutes, management of pre-game practice, complaints about the umpire's decision. I won't go into all of them, but once again, if possible, we don't want the umpire talking to themselves about issues. And so if possible, and we understand that numbers are sometimes difficult and you just can't have that additional person, but ideally it would be good to have obviously an umpire of the day, a side manager, and a person that wears the hat of the controlling body.
Excellent. We'll move on to the changes for this season. So, Bob, you're going to start with eligibility to play in finals.
Yes, that's it. Yeah, and there have been a number of changes in relation to the eligibility for finals. And first of all, in relation to Premier Division and Division One, the number of games to qualify for finals has been reduced from 8 games to 6 games throughout the season. Also in relation to Division One, the number of games to have played in a higher grade, that being the Premier Division, has also been reduced from 8 games to 6 games, and that would then enable a player who has played those 6 games in Premier Division to be also eligible to play in Division One finals. For the lower divisions, from divisions 2 down to 9, again, the number of games required to qualify for finals has been reduced from 6 games to 8 games. And again, in relation to divisions 2 to 9, the number of games played in a higher grade has been reduced from 6 games to 4 games, unless the player has played 4 or more games in the side concerned or a lower graded side. So we can see on weekend pennant, in most cases, the qualification requirements has been reduced by 2 games from 8 to 6. Looking at the midweek divisions 1 to 6, again, the number of games to qualify has been reduced from 6 to 4 games in that case. Moving on to interchange of players between sides prior to the finals. The change here relates to the round at which the games count, and that has been reduced from the last 4 rounds to the last 3 rounds. And the requirement there is that no side will include more than 2 players who have played the majority of their games in combined higher graded sides. So that majority of games in higher grades starts from round 3 and not from round 4, as was the case last season. Personal electronic devices and communication devices, as we know, they are, or particularly phones, are not permitted on the green unless a previous approval has been granted by the umpire of the day. An exemption has now been introduced into the conditions of play to enable electronic devices relating to the scoring to be able to be used on the green for scoring purposes only. So that'll cater for the situations where live scoring is used, both maybe at the venue only, where it's electronic scoreboard that can be updated from end to end on the green, and also for situations where the live scoring may be posted on the website.
That's a lot clearer because we've had a lot of questions. We're sort of flagged that we're potentially going to go down the line of a digital scorecard, and a lot of people or you can't have your phone on the green. So there is an exemption there now, isn't there?
Yes. Yeah, that'll meet for that need, and it'll start this season and hopefully progress over the coming seasons to across the board.
Can I just, while we're talking about electronic devices and exemptions, if a bowler is a member of emergency services, so firemen, firewomen, ambulance, police, they can have their mobile phone on them, but they need to let the umpire know, and they need to have their phone on silent, on vibrate. And also there are sometimes players that may have an emergency, possible emergency happening at home or somewhere else, so that they can use it then, but also they must tell the umpire why they've got the phone on them, and it should be on silent and on vibrate.
Good point, John.
Okay.
All right, Bob.
Moving on to the finals format for both midweek and weekend competitions. Dealing with the midweek Division One, the quarterfinals we have now been able to do away with byes in the quarterfinal stage as a result of the number of sides per section being reduced from 10 sides down to 8 sides. So fortunately, that does away with the bye that previously existed. For Division One weekend, a significant change here is that the format of the finals will now be side one will play side four, side three will play side two, and the winner of one and four and two and three will then progress to the sectional finals. In all other divisions for both midweek and weekend, the finals will now be played on the basis of one versus two and three versus four, with the winner of one versus two progressing straight to the final and the loser playing the winner of position three and four in a preliminary final to determine who will play the winner of one versus two in the grand final. Previously, it was in those divisions all weekend and midweek, it was one versus four and two versus three, with a straight knockout competition and the winners only progressing then to play the final.
So that's a big change, isn't it?
Yeah, significant change there. But what it is intended to do is to reward the teams that finish at the top of the ladder, giving one and two a second chance, as opposed to the previous situation where a team could finish quite clearly on top and get knocked out by side four on the first weekend of the finals. So there's been a lot of requests and pressure from clubs to recognise the success of a team throughout the season that finishes on top and give them a second chance. So that also applies to the second chance to the team finishing second on the ladder at the end of the home and away rounds.
Yeah, and that puts one more game in our finals for sections, doesn't it?
It does, yes.
But we lose that game in the division that we had with those byes.
Yes, yep.
Perfect. And Premier, they've been having that system for a while, haven't they?
Yes, it's always been the case in Premier Division that they had the top two teams play off. The winner progressed straight to the final. The loser then plays the winner of the third and fourth team to determine who goes to the final.
Yeah, and I've done a lot of work with regional in setting up their finals, and majority of our regions, they have that same system.
Mm-hmm.
1v2, 3v4. Thanks, Bob.
Okay.
John, let's get into some conditions that I know our members still aren't quite clear on.
So tenant permits are fairly simple. So you belong to a club, and we call that your nominated club. So that's, if you like, your number one club. You can join other clubs. So you can be dual members of other clubs. And for the other club, you can play pennant. So if you're a nominated club and you want to play on a Saturday pennant, but for some reason you want to play with another club on Tuesday or midweek pennant, you can. And sometimes it can be related to work, where someone might live in the city but have a holiday house on the weekend. And so they'll want to play with their local club on Saturday, but during the week they'll play midweek. It's not difficult. You need to get a pennant permit form, and it's on the website from Bowls Victoria, and it must happen before round five. And if it happens after round five, or then there'll be no exemptions given. It needs to be very clear that if you want to apply for a permit to play pennant, then do it before round five. On that thing, just another reminder, which sometimes we get a little bit of confusion happening. With whichever club you nominate for, that's the club that, if you wish, you enter into your club singles or pairs or any competition that leads on beyond the club into region. So you can't, if you, for example, you can't play club singles in both of your clubs. So you have to nominate one. What you can play in both of your clubs are what I call the fun games, the social games, 100 up, vice presidents, whatever you want to call it, but only with permission of the actual club. So with your nominated club, that's accepted. But if you wanted to play 100 up in your other club, you just need to ask your club, is it okay to play 100 up with them as well? So just be really sure which club you wish to nominate with. You can't nominate to be in the singles for Club A, but you want to play pairs in Club B, heading towards state. Once you nominate your club, that's the club you need to stick with.
Sorry, John. Okay. So nominated club, is that the same as your primary club?
Yes, same. Yeah, primary club. Yep.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, your primary club. Okay, so the start of a game of pennant. So I think we all know that you've got 30 minutes to wait before the pennant game needs to start. So if we if we're waiting 30 minutes and we're short of a player, once it gets to the 30 minutes past, well, then you either continue on with a player missing or you may put in a substitute. Now, there's all sorts of interesting things have happened throughout the seasons. One of the classic ones is particularly when there's a significant amount of travel and when teams travel together in the one car and one car goes missing for whatever reason. So they could have a flat tire or they've got lost or who knows. So you've got, if you take Saturday, you've got 16, 4x4, and one whole team is missing, which means you've only got 12 players on Saturday. So you can wait 30 minutes and see if they turn up. Or what you can do is reorganise your three sides of four into three, into 4x3. So you can actually start pennant with three players in each team. So if it was 12, it would be 3x3. So then hopefully the missing team turns up, then they have to fill the second position of each of those sides. So you can't reconstitute all your teams again and reorganise them. So it has happened, and sometimes people don't realise you can. But what's more likely to happen is someone's missing, one person. So there are a couple of options. The other three teams ready to go can start, the team that's missing someone can either start with three players or they can wait and see if the player turns up within half an hour. If they do, well, then they just go into the side. What else was I going to say at that stage?
It's the second that you miss.
Yes, your players if the second is missing.
Yeah.
And in that case, the skips must carry the card. Okay.
And the opposition would have two bowls in a row too, wouldn't they?
Yep. John? So the second for the opposition would play two bowls in a row. Yep, that's absolutely correct. The other thing is, if the player turns up after the 30 minutes, so they're very late, then they can still join the game. if you put in a substitute and the player turns up late, you can still swap them over. So the person that's been written down to, well, basically on Bowsling to play in that team can play even if they're an hour late. They can still come into the game if they're one player short, or if they've got a substitute, they can take the place of the substitute.
Can the substitute skip in your
rank? No. Substitute can never skip. Okay, playing of music, not difficult. Some clubs play music, and it's, so long as it's appropriate music, and I've actually never been anywhere where the music's actually been inappropriate, but clearly it needs to be appropriate music and at a level that the skips and the players can actually hear each other from the other end. So if it's a situation where I've been at a club where I've had my rings happen to be on the side of the speakers and the music may not have been too loud for four rinks away, but for the rink that I'm on, it's too loud. So you have every right to ask the club to turn the music down. And if you if the club's not obliging, you then ask for the umpire, and the umpire then makes a decision in regards to music. But we don't get many complaints about music. I think people are accepting now that it's not unusual to play with music, but it just needs to be at a reasonable level. Pre-game pen and practice. It was introduced last year, and overall I'd have to say that it went well, particularly on Saturday. Tuesday, few issues, but I'll talk about that in a moment. But the one thing that we discovered, that there were some clubs who, during pen and practice, the side managers would wander off and do the draw for the rinks. So you cannot do the draw for the rinks until pre-game pen and practice has finished. So as you know, you've got half an hour before the game starts. So that's when that time comes. You've still got half an hour. The side manager has still got half an hour to get into the club room, do a random draw to get the game started. I've been in situations where the draw has taken place during practice and someone's come out to someone and said, "Hey, Fred, hop onto rink two because that's where you're going to be playing." So just be aware that it hasn't happened a lot, but it's happened enough for us to bring it up tonight in terms of pre-game pen and practice. Tuesdays has been an issue in some areas only because the game starts so early in the morning that we don't often give our greenkeepers enough time to get the green prepared. And we've even had an absurd situation where the greenkeeper is literally still rolling the green and players are playing on the, actually doing practice while the greenkeeper is rolling up the green. And I've actually had greenkeepers tell me that they've actually pushed the bowls with the rollers. So that's just ludicrous and totally disrespectful to the club and to the greenkeeper. So I would suggest, particularly if there's a lot of travel involved, I would really suggest, and I'm talking on Tuesdays, I would really suggest that you perhaps give the club a ring to see if the greens will be ready for pre-game practice. Otherwise, you could get there quite early after a long drive and have to sit there and wait because the greens aren't able to be prepared in time. So it doesn't happen a lot, but it did happen. So just be aware of that. The greenkeepers will do their best, but sometimes it's just impossible to get them ready, particularly early in the morning. I've talked about ring draws not to be conducted until pre-game practice is complete. Just a reminder, I think we're getting better at it. All cards must be shuffled. So you turn up as a side manager and there's four cards on the table. I suggest you collect them, you shuffle them and you put them back down and then put yours on top. So I'm not suggesting that some people do deliberately set it up so that Fred gets rink one every time he plays at home, and that needs to be avoided. I think that's about it from me.
Yep, great work, John.
Bobby.
Yes, back to me again. What I want to discuss at this stage is clause 33 of the conditions of play for Metro Pennant. And that relates to the awarding of points for an abandoned game. There's nothing new in relation to this provision, but I need to emphasise the way in which the 60 ends for a 16-player game operates. Using that as an example, if there are four teams in the side, with each team required to play 21 ends, a total of 84 ends would constitute the game. In the case of an abandonment, if 60 ends are reached, the game would be constituted and the result after 60 ends have been completed would stand. The 60 ends, though, is not an average of 15 ends per team, but a total of 60 ends for the side. So team may have completed 12 ends and the other may have completed 17 ends. Another one may have only completed 10 ends. It's the total number of ends completed by the four teams that make up the 60 ends to determine whether a result of an abandoned game is achieved. If less than 60 ends are completed across the four teams, the game would be abandoned and the points would be allocated as an abandoned game. And then again, the same applies for the teams with 12, 9 and 7 players respectively. It's a total of the number of ends of all teams within that side. And the abandonment of games is likely, in most cases, to occur as a result of heat or rain, which is covered under clause 36 in inclement weather. Again, no change here, but again, the need to clarify the situation in relation to the interruption to play in the event of heat or rain. The requirement is that if due to heat or rain, the start of play is delayed by up to 1 hour, the game is abandoned. Also, in the event of the game commencing but being interrupted due to heat or rain for 1 hour, the game is abandoned. And in that situation, we would refer back to clause 33 to determine whether 60 ends has been completed before the game was actually abandoned, if it had started and then became interrupted.
Sorry, Bob, just to stop you there, what would stop a game for heat and rain? So maybe deal with rain first.
So if at the start of game, it's considered that the green is too wet to play on and it hasn't been closed by the greenkeeper or the greens director at the home venue, players can wait for up to 1 hour for the green to be declared available to play. If they delay the start by more than an hour, the game is abandoned. Okay, and the points are split between the two sides. If, for another example, the game may start on time and at some stage during the game, the umpire calls an interruption to play, if the interruption is for 1 hour or greater, the game is abandoned. However, if the umpire calls an interruption to play and they are able to resume within the hour, the game commences as at the stage when it was interrupted. If there are, for example, two or even three interruptions to play throughout the game, the hour's time limit applies to each individual interruption. It is not a combination of the accumulative time over the two or three interruptions which may occur. So, it's not a cumulative total, but it is each interruption for up to 1 hour, or a delay in play, in the commencement of play for 1 hour, result in the the abandonment of play.
And it needs to be agreed by the side managers, doesn't it, in order to come off?
Well, in terms of the initially, yes, the side managers, if they cannot agree, one of the side managers can appeal to the umpire to determine whether the game continues or is interrupted or even abandoned for the day.
Yeah.
So initially, side managers address the question, and then if they are unable to reach agreement, the umpire will determine whether the game continues or not.
Yeah, it's a difficult one, isn't it, Ryan?
Rain is a difficult one, and
heat's a bit more straightforward, isn't it?
Yeah, heat is a little more straightforward because we have the particular temperature rate at which the game will be interrupted or abandoned. But rain is much more difficult. We've got to take into account the safety issues of the players as well as the protection of the green. And both issues need to be considered when calling an interruption to play or an abandonment of the game due to rain. So, moving on to the next clause that we need to emphasise again is relation to instantaneous penalties. No change here, but a need to clarify the situation where an instantaneous penalty may apply. And the umpire, by their own observation or by an appeal by the controlling body, a side manager or a skip, decides that a player or coach is non-compliant and non-compliant in relation to the laws or the conditions of play, they may impose an instantaneous penalty. I'll address the issue of the penalty in a minute, but actions which could also relate to the aspect of non-compliant actions like abusive language, threatening or intimidating language, use of obscene or offensive language, threats to personal physical violence would also be considered as unacceptable and could result in the umpire imposing an instantaneous penalty. And in that case, the penalty applied in the first instance is the loss of the number of shots that are in play by the opposing team. And if we take Pennant, for example, we've got if it's a side of four players, two bowls each, the number of bowls in use by the opposition would be eight shots, and therefore eight shots would be awarded to the opposing team in the event of an umpire imposing the instantaneous penalty. Now, umpires, we emphasise to them that this is not something that they would apply without due consideration, and we ask them to consider that when they are looking at the possibility of imposing the penalty. We don't want them to jump to a conclusion and instantly impose the penalty, but take into account the situation that applies, and sometimes a reminder to the players, the skip or the manager, of the consequences of the actions that the players may be behaving in is sufficient to ensure that any unsatisfactory behaviour or non-compliance is soon addressed once the players are aware of what the consequences of the breach are.
So just to clarify that, Bob, so if you're in a game and you feel like your opponents are intimidating you or their behaviour is not good enough, what should you do?
In the first instance, the skip of that side needs to appeal to the umpire.
So the player would go to their skip and let them know what's
happening? Let them know what's happening, yes.
Yep.
And the skip would appeal to the umpire. The umpire, in most situations, we would expect would speak to the opposing side manager, make them aware of what's happening in front of the player and the skip of the player concerned, and that would result in a warning. And then a subsequent offence would result in the application of the instantaneous penalty.
Thanks for that.
Okay. And the next one we need to address is clause 39, and again, it's nothing new in relation to it, but it's the smoking provisions. And In relation to the designated smoking areas, it's up to each individual club to identify the designated smoking area. And in some clubs, that may actually be outside the boundaries of the club. Again, each club is required to identify the designated smoking area, and that is the area in which smoking can be permitted. But regardless of whether the designated area is identified or not, smoking is not permitted on the green under any circumstances.
Or vaping.
Vaping is regarded as smoking under the definitions that we use within the conditions of play. Moving on to clause 43, again, nothing new here, but it deals with slow or delaying play. And on numerous occasions, concerns are expressed in Bowls, Vic, that some players, individuals in particular, may be very slow in the way that they play the game. Others may have concerns about skips providing advice or instructions to players, unnecessarily delaying play. And the request comes in, what can we do about it? Well, the conditions of play have in the past and as now contain the provisions relating to slow play. And the offence there for slow play, the provisions are addressed for non-compliance can result in a penalty being imposed by the umpire of the day if they consider the player or the skip is acting in a way that is actually delaying and interfering with the progress of the game. The provisions are there, have been there in the past, which will provide the umpire with the opportunity to impose a penalty for a slow or delaying play. The next clause to look at is clause
46. Before you go on, just want to give an example that's happened a few times just to make it clear in regards to slow play or delaying play. And it happens in a match that is very close in score. So a rink cannot stand and wait for another rink to finish to see, if you like, to see what shot that the skip's going to play. So you need to play at your normal pace. And if you finish early, you finish early. You can't wait to stand back and wait to see what the result of one particular end is. You need to keep playing your game at the pace you're playing. Okay.
Yeah. And just adding to that, there's nothing that can be done after the event. If a side is concerned about slow play by the opponent, they need to raise the issue with the umpire of the day at the time, because nothing can be done after the event in relation to slow play.
Yep.
Moving on to the next clause we need to address is clause 46, dealing with bowler's arms. Again, no change here, but it appears that the policy is not clearly understood out in bowls land. And the requirements in relation to the bowler's arm is that once a player commences using the arm, they must continue to use it for the remainder of the game, but they are not required to use it for the delivery of the jack. So a player may start the game by using their arm, they must then continue to use it. In other situations, a player may start the game by delivering by hand and find that at a later stage in the game, they need to use the arm. They can pick up the arm at a later stage, but once they have started to use it, they must continue to use it. So it is not a requirement to use it for every end of the game, but it is a requirement that once you start to use it, you must continue to use it. And that applies to the delivery of bowls, but not to the delivery of the jack, which can be delivered by hand or by the bowler's arm. Okay.
Thank you, Bob and John. Definitely some more conditions a lot clearer now, and I'm guarantee our bowlers are going to benefit a lot from what you've just done. So, and appreciate the time that you've given us today, because we know you've been in meetings all day. I'll get Jimmy to come on. We'll stop our sharing and let's have a look at some of the questions that were raised throughout the session.
Thanks, mate. There's a few come up. I've answered most. A few I've left through to this Q&A session, but feel free to keep sending them in. I'll just read them out as they sort of come in. I'm going to work from the ones that came in first. So give me a second. Where are we? Matt, is there a reason we don't have permits, the pennant permits on Bowsling? There is a reason, but I can't put my finger on it.
Yeah, that's a good question. It's something that we're looking at with the developers. So unfortunately, it's not something that we can apply at the moment. But I understand the reason. We've been able to put transfers into Bowsling now. So hopefully we can get pennant permits applied the same way.
Cool. Going back to music, Bob and John, an example from last year is a side playing away in finals. They requested the music be turned off, and the umpire, I believe they said no. So the umpire, it's then the umpire's decision to rule whether the music is too much or not enough.
Yes, Jimmy, that's the case. The appeal can be to the umpire on the day in relation to the music, and the club that lodged the complaint has the opportunity to refer that after the game to Bowls Victoria. It's not going to make any difference on the day, but it gives the Bowls Victoria the opportunity to investigate what did actually take place and determine whether the umpire took the appropriate action or not.
Okay, yeah, awesome. Thanks, mate. You answered the second question on that. On to inclement weather, which is always a fun one. Situation where on a synthetic green, they were playing in drizzle. The opposition said the greenkeeper had been and closed the green for the day. Should have they waited the hour as per the conditions of play? That's what they should have enforced, correct?
No, the greenkeeper can close the green at any stage, okay, prior to or during a game.
Even synthetic, yes.
And the other thing you need to understand is that you could have some greens that have been closed, but another green at the same club being open. So you could have some teams playing and others not at the same club. So
play nicely is the advice there, yeah? Jan's just clarifying, who makes the call on the abandonment? The umpire first, then the controlling body, or and the greenkeeper can overrule them both, sort of thing.
That's the order. If the side managers can't agree, they appeal to the umpire, and the umpire. In addition to that, the controlling body or the greenkeeper can step in and close the green.
Cool, no probs. With the instantaneous penalties, the 8 shots, where are they applied to the score, or how are they applied to the score? Is it on that end that it was given?
Yes,
that end of that ring.
Awesome.
And can I just also say, if that for some reason that player was still alive, because their teammates probably want to get rid of him, if that player repeat offended, they would be suspended, forfeited, told to leave, and they'd be reported to Bowls Victoria, and the game would continue where you cannot use a substitute.
Cool.
And just adding to that again, if the offending player in the first instance or another member of that team also was committed an instantaneous penalty, that team would then forfeit the game, and in a pennant game, that would result in forfeiture of the game overall. So two instantaneous penalties results in forfeiture of the game.
No props. Thanks, Bob. Bowler's arm, if it breaks during a game, can they replace it or play without an arm?
They can't play without an arm, but they can replace it.
No props. And if they can't find a replacement, Bob?
They cannot continue in the game. They would have to withdraw from the game. And
they could have a substitute.
Yeah, Okay.
Can they share a team member's arm?
Yes, there'd be nothing preventing them from sharing an arm.
Yep.
That'd be a funny sight. Can we just go over the heat rule again? So I'll go my understanding, which I'm pretty sure is right. If it gets to 36 during a game, you come off for up to an hour to see if it drops below 36 as per the bomb reading. That's the site of the club you're playing at. If it does not drop below the 36, game is off. If it goes under the 36, you can go back on until it gets back to 36 again. Can you have multiple hour delays?
As long as each delay is under an hour, yes.
Cool.
No problem. But at any stage within that hour, once it drops below 36, the game must recommence.
Okay.
Is there a time when the game has to be called off by, if we've got a lot of these interruptions?
Yes, the game must complete, a game commencing at 1 o'clock must be completed by 6 p.m. on that day.
So you've got 5 hours complete.
A game is resulting in interruptions has 5 hours in which to be completed. If there is no interruption to the play, there is no time limit on completion of the game.
Cool. Answers two questions. So, Barbara, I think you asked what was the temperature. It's 36. Just a question on conditions of arms. Once they're approved, like if there's a dent in the arm, no one's checking the conditions at any point of the arms, are they? Or
No, the arms, if the umpire checks, what's really important to make sure they've got the hologram on from Bowls Australia to say that it's approved. So there was a group of bowling arms that were manufacturers that didn't have the hologram on them. And if that's the situation, they need to contact BA with a photograph of their arm, and the BA free of charge will send them a sticker, a hologram. So I doubt whether an umpire would ever check, see or reject an arm because it had a dint in it. So you can't modify the arms in any way from the point of manufacture. You can add a bit of extra to the handle or something to help the grip, but you can't put extra screws on, you can't take screws off, you can't tamper with or modify any of the mechanisms on the arm.
Good, mate. Barry just asking what is the difference. He said midweek Div 1 finals versus other. I'm presuming you mean weekend Div 1 finals. We don't have enough time in the season to complete that version of Division 1 finals plus the promotion relegation game against Premier Division for the new Premier 2 for next season. So them Division 1 clubs were communicated this a while ago, so they're all au fait with it and all is good. Please clarify the rule coming off the green during a brief rain delay. So he said, is there a 10-minute rule? So my understanding is if you're off the green for under 10 minutes, you go back and commence the end where it was left off, correct?
Correct.
And if it's over 10 minutes, you restart that end or replay that end.
Yeah, the ends are dead. Yep.
And then there is the hour rule, Nigel, where if you can't come back on in the hour, then the game is abandoned. If you can come back on, then you... Obviously, if it's between 10 minutes and an hour, you'll have to replay the end.
Yep.
Awesome. Barbara just asking for a bit of clarification on a late player joins in at their nominated position. So if a player turns up 45 minutes late, they jump into where they were nominated to play, even if they were third or lead.
No, at that stage, the vacant position is the second position, whether that has been taken by a substitute or the left vacant, the player arriving late then takes their position, takes that role of the second player.
So if the team that was constituted, the missing player happened to be the skip, so the team would have to reorganise itself to work out who's going to skip. And then they either play with three or they get a substitute. Wherever the substitute plays, which can't be skip, that's where, and the late player turns up, that's where they play.
Awesome. Sweet. Peter saying, does the time limit also mean if 60 ends are played to have a result as well? So I'm presuming if we've played 61 ends total in a 16-a-side game and we've come off for an hour or we hit the time limit even, then it counts as a game played if you've gone over the 60 ends and not as a game played if you've gone under the 60 ends.
Correct. Once 60 ends have been completed, we have a constituted game and the result then stands.
No probs. Where do we have the 10-minute end? I'm presuming it's a law, the 10 minutes restart in the end. Like no. The break in play.
It's a stoppage to play.
Yeah.
So the difference between an interruption to play and a stoppage. So that's an interruption to play. That law, did they want to know the actual law?
I'm presuming it's a law and not in our conditions of play, judging by no one finding it, or is it in our conditions of play? I've looked at it so many times. Of now, I was against square.
No, it's not in the conditions of play. As John was explaining, it's either an interruption to play or a stoppage. An interruption for play should not be for more than 10 minutes, and an interruption to play occurs when players of their own volition decide to leave the green. That might be due to a shower of rain and they go to get their wet weather gear, or they step off to get some shelter at that time. If they're off for 10 minutes or more, the umpire should intervene and determine that it is a stoppage to play. Once called by the umpire a stoppage to play, the play can only commence when the umpire determines that it is safe or practical to do so.
So Law 32 talks about game stoppages.
Cool. So that's law, not conditions of play. So these conditions of play are in addition to the laws of the sport.
So our umpires need to be really switched on with wet weather. To know whether it's a stoppage and whether they can come back.
Also, side managers need to be switched on as well.
Sure. So that answers that one. The time limit, Stuart, is covered in 36.225. So midweek and weekend panic games that are interrupted will be abandoned after 5 hours from the scheduled start time. So if it's a 1 p.m. normal scheduled start time on a weekend, that'll be 6 p.m. If it's 10:30 on a midweek, that'll be 3:30 p.m. If my maths is right.
So this might be the time to talk about if a game is scheduled, so it's a Saturday panic game, the game is scheduled for schedule the game for Friday and the game never starts because it's wet, it's raining, it's hailing, it's a warm, whatever, it hasn't started. Well, then they can play the game on Saturday. If the game on Friday night starts and it's wet and it's raining and it's interrupts the game stopped, they can't restart the game the next day.
Yep, sweet. Couple of questions on schedule breaks. So someone, Diane, hello Diane, has said that the opposition team manager tells you they were playing straight through. Depending on what division you're playing in, Diane, they're not allowed to do that. So midweek and any division except Premier League on the weekend, a 30-minute break is to be taken unless agreement can be made that you won't take the break. So you can't have a home side or an away side saying, no, we're playing straight through unless it's done by agreement. So the default is there is a break. If there is agreement, then there can be no break. But the default is there is a break. So that answers Noel's question that just snuck in there as well. So unless you're Premier League, the default is break unless you can agree not to. Yes, the break has to be taken, Matt, unless you can agree not to take the break.
And I think we have a lot of players who are still unsure what time that break starts too, don't we?
Yeah.
30 minutes or 20 minutes break?
Well, that's a good question because it depends on what club you are and where you're at. Some club players get out there pretty quick and others sit around and have a second cup of tea. So it's very hard to get people out of the clubhouse if they're stopped. So is there an actual time for the stoppage?
30 minutes.
30 minutes?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Now, if it's raining and it's looking pretty miserable, both sides, and have decided to have a break, both sides could decide to have the break then and then use up 30 minutes having a break rather than waiting around to see if the rain stops. So just use your common sense and get agreement for both side managers.
Awesome. And then someone's just clarifying the 6 p.m. finish. I believe I've got the right answer to this, Bubba John, but correct me if I'm wrong. So they said if an end's in progress and it clicks to 6 p.m., what happens then? If the end has already started and that the end started is declared by the jack roll, then you complete the end. So even if you end up finishing at 6:04, as long as the jack was rolled prior to 6 p.m., you're good to go. And 6 p.m. being a weekend, traditional 1 p.m. game start example.
Yep, that's correct, Jimmy. And in the event of that end commencing and becomes a dead end, it needs to be replayed until completion of that end.
Yep.
Sweet. Wow. Quite a few questions on the break. I'm pretty sure we've cleared this up. But yes, there is breaks for weekend and midweek, unless you're Premier Division. There is breaks unless you can agree not to.
Well, traditionally, Tuesday, Penrith stops for lunch.
And yes, Jan, you can agree on no break in midweek or weekend. And then I've got a few people asking about the break and the 60-minute delay period. A bit like cricket, exercise some common sense on this. If it's raining and you schedule your break, include that break within the 60-minute stepping off the green period. That's the sensible thing to do. Or if you know rain's due at 4:30 p.m., don't take the break and play through so you can get your game played. I'm sure we're all here to complete games of bowls, not just waste our afternoon. So it's common sense. I know it's lacking in the world currently, but surely we can lead the common sense example in lawn bowls.
Would that go with heat as well? If you know it's going to be a really hot day, can you start your game a bit early?
Oh, yes. Absolutely, mate. I've seen that happen a few times. That's all the questions gone. I'll give it another minute, see if any more pop through.
I think you've done a great job, Jimmy.
Thanks, mate.
All right. Well, thanks again, John and Bob. Really appreciate giving up your time, considering you've been at meetings all day today. So as you can see from those questions, our members do have a lot of questions and need clarity, and we really appreciate your support. So thank you again.
Pleasure.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
I'll just finish with some support at BV. So we've just had Jimmy on there, events and competitions manager. That's Jimmy's details if you need to give him a call or send him an email. Amanda deals with admin for a lot of our membership and events. So if you're looking at transfers, questions with Bowls Link, Amanda's the person to go to. You can contact me. I'm the education and training manager. So if you need some training at your club around these sort of things or with coaching and officiating, I'm the person to come to. And as you can see, our experts tonight, John and Bob, they're the Officiating Laws Committee co-chairs, and they're their details. So thank you again for joining us. Another training video from Bowls Victoria, and have a great season. See you all.